worship together. To God be the glory. Welcome. To God be the glory. God has been faithful this week, and he will be the next. And our next song is Faithful One.
Faithful One, so unchanging. To you again. of trouble. You lift me up when I fall down. All through the storm, your love is the anchor. My hope is in you alone.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. On our last Sunday of August, I don't know how that happened. It's hard to believe that September is coming very quickly in the next few days. We'd like to extend a warm welcome to those who are visiting with us today. We hope that you will feel welcomed and encouraged. We're glad you're here. This morning, just a few announcements. If you look in your bulletin, our bulletin has lots of information in it. We encourage you to take it home, pray for the people in the bulletin through the week, reach out to those whose birthdays and anniversaries are this week to wish them blessings. Just a couple things I'd like to draw your attention to. September 10th, we are having our church picnic at TMBC. So September 10th, there will be no service here at our church. We will be meeting at TMBC at 10 a.m., and we will be hearing testimonies and welcoming people into our church membership and having a lunch after. So please plan to join us for that. It's always a wonderful time, our church picnic at TMBC. Also, Sunday school begins on September the 17th. Did you have an announcement, Elaine? Come on up.
So we had a really awesome vacation Bible school, and there's a report on how many kids there was. There was over 100 kids. And I put this sign up at the back, so if the print's too small in the bulletin, you can just take your phone and make sure that you register your children for Sunday school, and the website's in your bulletin, and I also have this back where the family pictures are for the church family. I also like to encourage you to tap someone on the shoulder and say, I think you'd make a really good Sunday school teacher. And you can just teach for blocks of 3 or 4 weeks at a time if you wish. Wendy Thiessen and I are on the Sunday school committee along with Steve, and we really need people who can be flexible in their schedules because we're up against hockey season and basketball season and volleyball season and all kinds of other seasons besides Sunday school. And so there are people who are willing to sub, so if you would be willing to do that, please reach out to me. And I will be giving you a tap on the shoulder because I know where you live. Thank you.
Thank you, Elaine. As an advocate of someone who loves Sunday school, teaching is so much fun. And I have an experience where a few years ago I was looking for some Sunday school teachers, and I approached a gentleman by the name of John Nickel. And John was this amazing man, full of wealth and wisdom. And he was in his 70s, and I asked him if he would step in and teach our senior youth boys for a season and just for a few weeks at a time. And John looked at me and said, I don't think I can really do that. I think someone younger needs to do that. I don't really think that's a space for me. And I just said, John, would you just do 1 week? Would you just hang out with our guys 1 week and give it a try? And John came out of that Sunday school room and he was glowing. And he said, I'll come back. I'll do that again. And he just loved the experience. And what that taught me was that anyone of any age is able to teach Sunday school. So if you are interested at all, please do talk with Elaine or Wendy. We would love to have you join our Sunday school team. The kids are amazing, and you learn so much from kids when it comes to faith and Sunday school, as well as you just grow so much in your own faith as you're digging in and preparing for the week. So Sunday school starts September 17th. And also, just wanting to draw your attention, we now formally have a church name change committee with people from our congregation who have agreed to sit on that committee. And we would just encourage you to please be praying for the church name committee for prayer and discernment as they begin in the next number of weeks to gather and to start talking through that process. It's gonna be a space that needs prayer and time and discernment. So please join us as we pray for each person on that committee. And we just want to say thank you so much to those of you who have agreed to join that committee and to do that work on our behalf. Are there any other announcements this morning? All right, let's pray. I will invite the ushers forward. And I'm going to pray, and then I have a verse I'll share. All right. Also, we also wish to extend our condolences to Bonnie Unruh and her family. Her father has recently passed away. So if you're thinking of Bonnie, please pray for them and the family, and reach out and send words of encouragement. Father God, we thank you so much for this morning. God, we thank you for your goodness and for your mercy, Lord. We thank you that we can come here this morning and gather. And Lord, we just pray this morning that everything we say and do will be honoring to you, Jesus. We pray that you would give us hearts that are soft, ears open, ready to hear, and hands ready to receive, Lord, and that you would meet us. Father, we pray that you would especially be with Bonnie and her family during this difficult time. Jesus, we pray for comfort and for peace, Father, as they prepare for what is to come in her father's funeral. And Lord, we just thank you so much for Bonnie and her family. And God, we just ask that you would meet them in the grief and in the loss. And Father, we thank you that in you we can find comfort. Father, we also think of upcoming ministries. We think of Sunday school, and we think of our picnic in a couple weeks, Lord. And we just ask that you would be in all of those details. Thank you, Lord, that we can gather. Thank you for the freedom that we have. Lord, we also ask that you, Father, would bless the tithes and offerings this morning, that you would bless the hands that give it, Lord, and that these would be used for your glory. And we thank you so much, Lord, that you give us so much, and in turn, we can give back a little bit. So, Father, thank you for this morning. We pray that you would be with us, and you go ahead of us into our service. In Jesus' name, amen. And our call to worship this morning comes out of Psalm 100, and it says, "Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him singing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us, and we are his." Please join us as we worship together.
So much of our life with Jesus is his invitation to us. And so we want to sing a song that describes God, and we just pray that you would apply this to any area in your life where you need to know that God is Lord of all.
Maker of the moon and stars, stirrer of the seas, tender of the earth that feeds me. Spun. You are Lord of all.
All the kids come on up and join me up here. Come on up, guys. Hi, Sage. Hi. Come on and take a seat around. Come on up. Welcome here. Come on up. You guys can fill the carpet in. I don't bite, I promise. All right, who knows what we had happen at our church this last week? VBS, yes. We had over 100 kids in the building, didn't we? And do you know what the theme was this year? Stellar space. Solomon, what was your favorite thing around the building? It was pretty decorated. It was amazing. For those of you who didn't have the opportunity to be in the building last Sunday or through this week, our VBS team and decorating team did an amazing job. The south hallway was like a black hole, and it was floor to ceiling, black walls with stars and black lights and balloons, and it was amazing. And then we had a spaceship literally in the corner of our foyer, and then there were lots of balloons and things all over the building. It was a fantastic week. Does anyone remember what day one was about? Zeke. Well, it was about Jesus's birth, right? And the line was, when life is dark, what do? Shine Jesus' light. Yeah. And then day two, do you remember? Pastor Jeff climbed a tree a few different times. Remember that one? Anyone remember? Yes. It was Zacchaeus, yes. And the line was, when people don't get along, shine Jesus' light, yes. And then day three, remember, we lined one of the aisles here and we had a bit of a parade and a party. And do you remember what the story was about, Alice? Do you remember? It was when Jesus entered Jerusalem and everyone was celebrating. Remember, he came in and we took away from that. When good things happen, what can you do? Shine Jesus' light, yes. And then on Thursday was a harder story because we learned about Jesus' death and his resurrection. And what we learned from that was, when life is sad, Solomon, what can you do? Shine Jesus' light, yes. And then on day five, we learned about Philip helping the Ethiopian man understand God's word. And when people need help, what can you do? Shine Jesus' light. Yes, so all week we learned about shining Jesus' light in all different kinds of circumstances. So tell me, what were your favorite parts of VBS? Does anyone have a favorite memory they want to share? Yes.
The video of our buddies.
The video of the bunnies? That was a good one. Thank you for sharing. Does anyone else have anything they want to share? Come on up. Everything was good. Everything was good. It was an amazing week. So we want to say thank you again to our volunteers who came together to make it happen, and for our families for bringing their children to support VBS. It always is quite a bit of a whirlwind, but we had so much fun. Does anyone have anything else that they'd like to share? Yes. The music was really good, wasn't it? What was your favorite song? You don't have one? Do you remember all the actions? A few of them? All right. So we're going to do one song. We're going to put it up on the screen. Would you guys be willing to turn around and share it with our church family? A shine? Shine? And then we'll show the slideshow we did again. So Paul, if you can put the song Shine up, please. And everyone, we're going to stand up. And we're going to do it. All right? Well, yes, you can go on the stage if you would like. Absolutely. All right, guys, come on over here and sit with me, and we'll watch the slideshow together. As you can tell, it was such a great week. So let me pray for you guys. And then the ladies over here need your help with a little bit of singing when we're done. So if you guys can stay up here for another minute, we would appreciate it. All right, I'm going to pray for you. Lord God, thank you so much for each one who's here. We thank you so much for the great week of EBS we had. And Father, I just pray that you would remind each of the kids here how loved they are and how valued they are, Lord, and how much they matter to you. Father, we thank you that Jesus loves us and that we matter. And Lord, I just pray that this week you would bless them. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, come on up on stage.
And there's no way we can match the enthusiasm, but let's sing This Little Light of Mine together. And you guys are going to lead us, okay? In This Little Light of Mine? Can you lead us? Okay. So they're going to lead us, and we're all going to sing together. Let's stand. The words are a little bit different than usual, and we'll sing what's up there. Okay, we guys got to sing loud. We're going to clap. Standing, we're going to sing another one. Kids, you can go sit down, but kids, we need your part here too. This is going to be a new song, and the kids are going to sing, and I won't be afraid anymore, Ronki. Yeah. And I won't be afraid anymore. Kids, that's your part. I won't be frightened anymore. Kids, can you help me out? And I won't be frightened anymore. One more time. Come on, kids. And I won't be frightened anymore. Okay, and the adults are going to sing a different version. Everybody can sing every part, but we really need the kids on the... And I won't be frightened anymore. You guys can do that one really loud. And the adults are going to sing a different part, and it's so much fun.
Let's just do it.
Your love is washing over me. Your love is washing over me. Your love is washing over me. And I won't be frightened anymore. Your mercy's washing over me. Your mercy's washing over me. Your mercy. grace is washing over me. Your peace is washing over me. And I won't be frightened anymore.
Let's sing.
Your love is washing over me. Your love is washing over me. Your love is washing over me. And I won't be frightened anymore. And I won't be frightened anymore. And I won't be frightened anymore.
Thanks. You can sit. We are going to sing another one, but you can sit for this one. This is, again, kids, I won't be frightened anymore. Sometimes the frightening things and the worries and the fears come at night, even for adults. Sometimes adults stay awake at night thinking and worrying and praying. And this is a lovely reminder that even at night, when the frightening and scary things come, God never slumbers nor sleeps. So let's sing together. It's very easy. Lots of repeats.
Amen. Thank you. Paul, could you turn the pulpit light on for me? Yes, I'm that. There it is. Wonderful. Thank you. Well, this summer we have been doing a series simply called One. And we've been looking at different stories in the Bible, individuals and their encounters with the Lord. And we've been mainly focusing in the Gospels and the stories of Jesus and how he would encounter one person. Often, even in a multitude of people or a crowd of people, he would single out the one. And it's interesting because a lot of the times the person that he singles out is somebody that's been a cast off from society. It's somebody who is unclean or not moral enough, and they're outside of society's circle. And Jesus finds them or goes out of his way to meet with the one and give them dignity and worth. And this morning, I want to do something a little bit different here this morning as we end the summer and head into September. I want to flip that around a little bit, and I want to begin with the multitude or the many, with the crowd, if you will, and then see if we can make our way back to the one. There's no doubt that the Jesus movement is the most ethnically diverse religious movement in the history of the world. The Jesus movement is the most ethnically diverse religious movement that the world has ever seen. Somehow, we would say, in the person of Jesus, in the story of Jesus, the message of Jesus, the life of Jesus, the death and the resurrection, in the person of Jesus, the deepest longings and the needs of every human heart can be met. No matter the color of your skin or the language that you speak or the country that you reside in, people who are completely different than you and I, who live on the other side of the world, speaking a different language, are bowing the knee to Jesus, being filled with his spirit to enable them, empower them to follow Jesus just like you and I. In fact, in the final book of the Bible, in the Revelation, John sees a picture of the church, a picture of the family of God in its final state. And a number of times we get this picture in the Revelation, and we're told that this final picture of the church of God is made up of people from every tribe, every nation, every people, in every language, in its final state. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that a beautiful picture? Jesus himself, when he gave his last commission to his disciples, when he sent them out, he said, "Go, therefore, now go and make disciples, more disciples of him. Go make disciples of what? All nations. Reach every nation." And in fact, at one point, he seems to allude to, he's promised that he will return again one day, but at one point he seems to allude that he will not return until all nations have heard the good news of his kingdom. In Matthew 24:14, he says, "And this gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all the nations, and then the end will come." The gospel of Jesus Christ can speak to every human heart in every jungle, on every island, on every mountaintop, in every prairie. Don't forget about the prairies. The message of Jesus can reach all people on planet Earth. In the city of Nazareth, where Jesus grew up, it was a village. Now it's a city. In the city of Nazareth, there's a church there. It's called the Church of Annunciation. And it's basically it's a memorialization of Jesus or Mary receiving the word that she would be with child. And the church is filled with all of these different art pieces. In the courtyard outside and in the church, there is a couple hundred different art pieces picturing the Madonna and child, or Mary and Jesus. But what's fascinating about it is that it was commissioned. They commissioned people from all kinds of different countries to send in an art piece from their original culture, their unique culture's art to depict this picture. And almost every country in the world is represented there. But when you see the pictures, it's fascinating to see that in the pictures, Jesus is pictured. The picture of Jesus, coming from all these different countries, they picture Jesus in their own ethnicity. Now, we all do this, don't we? I mean, you can probably remember pictures of Jesus of holding a lamb or a halo around him, but the picture probably for most of us in our minds is a white European male, right? We all picture Jesus in our own ethnicity. And when I first heard this and I thought of that, I thought, that's just crazy. Right? I mean, it's just weird that we all project onto Jesus our own ethnicity. It's strange. But I heard something once, and it really challenged me, and it really rocked me to the core when I heard this, and it challenged me to think of this in the opposite way. And they were saying that, what if it is the opposite that's true? Not so much that we are projecting onto Jesus our own ethnicity, but what if it's the opposite, that Jesus is so vast, the message of Jesus is so broad, that it reaches to every different ethnicity. So Jesus, in essence, is projecting himself onto every different ethnicity, so that if we believe in him, he becomes our brother, no matter where we are from. It's the nature of Jesus, his identity, the story of Jesus that is meant to go forth into every culture. And when someone believes, no matter who they are, where they are from, they become his brother. What Jesus does is he takes that which has been divided, and we're divided in this world by many different things through borders or race or language. It divides us. And what the story of Jesus does is it takes it and it turns that around and it unites people. People on the other side of the planet with a different color of skin, speaking a different language, under a different flag, become my brother and my sister in Christ. United under a new kingdom, a new family under a new king. Just to give you a picture of the diversity of the family of God, there was a book that was written by a man named Philip Jenkins, I think about 10 or 15 years ago. And he's talking about the diversity of the family of God. And at that time, there was about 2 billion people on planet Earth who claim to follow Jesus. And in his book, he said that, just to give you a picture of this diversity, he said the largest of that group, of that 2 billion, is still, as you might expect, people of European descent, which makes up about 530 million of that 2 billion. But close behind is Latin America, coming in at 510 million. And then Africa at 309 million. And then Asia at 300 million. He goes on to say, that by, and now we're closer to this than when the book was written, so I'd be curious to see where we're at. But if the projections continued on, he would say by the year 2025, it would become a two-horse race of the largest contingent of Christianity between Africa and Latin America. And then he said, in the not-so-distant future, there's no doubt that the largest contingent of Christianity would belong to Africa. The face of Christianity would be Africa. He had another quote too, and he was saying, when you picture an average Christian, what comes to your mind? The largest grouping of people in the family of God, the average Christian, what comes to your mind? And he says this, he said, you should think of a woman living in a village either in Nigeria or Afalfala, a shanty town in Brazil, and probably someone who by typical American standards is inconceivably poor. So I want you just to see, just to begin with, just the many, okay? The diversity of the family of God, the across the planet, the many, the multitude of every language, every people, every culture, every nation, the many. Now I want to try to work our way back to the one. Because even though Jesus is so broad and the message of Jesus is so great and so vast that it reaches into every culture, or it can reach into every culture on the earth, we also need to acknowledge that Jesus came from a family. He was born into a community. He was part of a people. He was under a nation. And that ethnicity was crucial to his story. You see, if you go back to Genesis chapter 12, we come to a hinge point in the story of God, in the biblical story, an incredibly important passage in the story of God. And if you read up to that point, if you read the first 12 chapters of Genesis, you'll see very quickly that humanity finds itself going off the rails very quickly. Chaos comes into humanity very quickly. In fact, by just chapter 6, just 6 pages into the story, if you will, depending on the size of the print of your Bible, but just 6 chapters into the Bible, you'll find God saying that he's grieved in his heart that he's even created humanity because there's so much wickedness and evil and violence that's come into the human story. But one finds favor in the eyes of God. Noah finds favor in the eyes of God, and God starts over with Noah and his family. But again, immediately after that, if you keep reading, you see that humanity goes off the rails again very quickly. And we get this story in Genesis chapter 11 of all the people of the earth coming together in a sense of unity, and they're building a city and a tower. But the story makes it clear that the people are coming together in a sort of arrogance towards God, right? We are going to make our name great. We are going to do it in our own way, in our own eyes. But again, right after this story, we go in Genesis 10, we're given a table of the nations of Noah and his family and his sons and their descendants. And we get this picture of all the nations, all the people of the earth. And then we get the story of the Tower of Babel and all the people coming together. And then God brings judgment when he comes down and he scatters the people and he confuses their language. But we get this picture of the many, of the multitude, of all the peoples of the earth. But then immediately after that, we get to the one again. In Genesis, at the end of Genesis chapter 11, we're introduced to him, beginning in verse 31. people Terah, who is a descendant of Shem, who is a son of Noah, took Abram, his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, his grandson, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went forth together from Ur of the Chaldeans to go into the land of Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. The days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. And then Genesis 12, verse 1. And the story focuses in on the one. Now the Lord said to Abram, and if you're reading through the story, that should just stop you in your tracks. God is coming to one. God is speaking to one. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land I will show you, and I will make you a great nation. And I will bless you and make your name great. Now you remember what just happened in the story right before this? All the peoples of the earth were coming together and they were building this city and this tower, and they were going to make their name great. They were going to do it. Now God takes the one and he says, I will make you great. I will make your name great. So that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Genesis 12 is really a hinge point in all of Scripture. Now God has chosen one from the many. And the story is going to focus in on the one and his descendants. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and the nation of Israel. God's chosen people. But why did God choose the one over the many? Why did God choose the one over the others? Well, I'll tell you why. Because he could, and he did. But listen, God chose. Remember the story leading up to this. God chose because humanity was a mess. Okay, that's key to the story. And you read the rest of the story, even God's chosen people are going to choose wrong more than they choose right. But here's what I want you to hear. God doesn't choose as we choose or how we think God chooses. We think, why did God choose the one over the other? But he didn't. Listen carefully to what he says in his covenant to Abram, who will become Abraham, of course. He doesn't choose the one over the other. He chooses the one for the others. I choose you. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. Why? So that through you, read it. What does it say? Through you, the one, in you, Abraham, all the families of the earth will be blessed. And that's why when you come to the New Testament, and you come to the story of Jesus, you open the New Testament, in the book of Matthew, what do you come to first? In the story of Jesus, what's the first thing that we come to? Not the Christmas story. We come to this, what seems to us this strange genealogy of all these names. But it's a story pointing back to Abraham. It's a story pointing back 42 generations to show that Jesus comes from Abraham. That Jesus is an Israelite from the tribe of Judah, and he becomes the fulfillment of the blessing to all the families of the earth. through him, through Abraham, I will bless all the families of the earth. And now through this story of Jesus, all the families of the earth can be blessed. All the peoples of the earth can be brought back to unity. All the peoples of the earth can be brought back into one family under God. I will bless you so that you become a blessing. I will bless you so in you all the peoples of the earth will be blessed. From the one to the many, God reaches to the ends of the earth. But I want you to see this, that God chooses not as we choose, okay? God chooses not one over the other, but he chooses the one for the others. Can you see that in the story? God chooses the one for the others. Now he tells us that we have been chosen. We are a chosen people. So what does that mean? Have you been blessed by the story of Jesus? Has the grace of God, the mercy of God been poured into you? Then if you have been blessed, then according to the narrative of the Bible, then you are to be a blessing to those around you. Amen? The community that we live in should be blessed because we live in it, because we belong to the family of God, because we have received the grace and the mercy of God. You remember reading through the Gospels, and you remember how Jesus is so hard on the religious leaders? Why? Because they had forgotten the whole story. They'd messed up the whole story. They had been filled with this arrogance, with this self-righteousness, and now we are the chosen people, so we are better than everyone else. We look down on everyone else, right? We wouldn't even associate with those Gentile dogs. We would never go into their house. We think we are better than them because we are chosen by God. And Jesus is always speaking into that. He's always challenging that. You hypocrites, you brood of vipers. Right? God has chosen you, not so that you think you're better than everyone else. God has chosen you so that you might become a blessing to everyone around you. And Jesus comes as the true Israelite, showing the way. Always a blessing to those he comes in contact with. We've looked at that over the last few weeks, right? The one. Always serving, always blessing, always giving love and kindness to those he comes in contact with. Giving dignity to those who have been cast out. The true Israelite. But the religious leaders and the people of the day, they've forgotten that. That they have been called to be the light of the world. A city on a hill. You know, the church becomes just like that when we become filled with legalism or we become filled with this self-righteousness. If we think that we're better than anybody else, if we look down our noses at our neighbors and we think, oh, I'm part of God's family, so I'm better than them. I'm more moral than them. Forget about it. God chose you. He blessed you. He poured out his mercy into you so that you might become a blessing to those around you. The community that you live in should be blessed if you are a part of God's family. The poor should be fed. The sick should be prayed for and comforted and helped. The bereaved should be brought along beside. I was in the hospital yesterday sitting with Bonnie and her family. And when I was leaving, I met Patty White coming in. And she's part of the palliative care team. Right? She had a basket full of goodies in her hands. Why? To bless those who are suffering. Right? And when I was in the room, the family talked glowingly of this quilt that was on Ray's body as he laid in the bed beside us, given to them by the palliative care team. The community that you live in should be blessed. right? We shouldn't look down upon people around us. We should be so filled with the mercy of God, with the grace of God, that it pours out of us, right? And as soon as we become conceited, as soon as we become arrogant, we're just like that Tower of Babel. And the mercy and the grace is like a faucet. It's just turned off and it doesn't flow from us. It's trapped, just like the religious leaders of Jesus' day. But when we're filled, when we're reminded, when we're marinating in the grace of God, it should flow from us. And our community should know it. They should see it. They should hear it. They should find it. Amen? It should ooze out of us. We're so marinated in his grace that it comes forth with us, from us. We shouldn't be like a tough, chewy steak. We should be beautiful and marinated in the grace of God, right? That's why he calls us. He says, when you come together, next week we'll be taking communion together, right? Come together and sit in this remembrance of the grace of God. Jesus, whose life was poured out for you. Sit in it. Paul says that we should be continually growing in it. Grow in the grace and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Grow in it. Marinate in it. That it oozes out of you. And our neighbors know it. Our government is blessed because of it. Because we're praying for them. The people around us know it. And they see it. And they hear it because we are the people of God. I've blessed you so that in you, all the people around you might be blessed. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we give you thanks for the story of God, and we give you thanks for most of all, the grace of Jesus that's been poured into our hearts. And Father, we give you thanks for the picture that we've seen this morning of the family of God made up of every tribe, every language, every color of people. And one day when we gather together to sing praise to you, we will have the full assortment of people together, worshiping you together. What a picture that will be. And Father, as we go forth from this place, I pray that we would be filled with the grace and the knowledge of Jesus. We would be filled with the message of Jesus. And it would come forth from us. Your grace, your love, and your kindness would show forth in every relationship, every interaction that we have. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us stand in response and equipped. Thanks, Jeff. We are equipped. Let us sing, "We Are One in the Spirit." Thank you.
save each one's pride, and they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father, from whom all things come, and all praise to Christ Jesus.
Amen. Thank you. It's interesting. Paul's letters always begin and end with words of grace. Grace to you. He closes the Thessalonians' first letter with simply the words, "The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you." Amen.